Welcome to Stonington High School for the 18th District Senatorial Debate. The 18th District covers the towns of Griswold, Groton, North Stonington, Plainfield, Preston, Sterling, Stonington, and Voluntown. Tonight's debate is presented by The Day and the Chamber of Commerce of Eastern Connecticut. It's being presented live on theday.com. The League of Women Voters of Southeastern Connecticut are providing the timekeepers. We will have this video of this event remaining available on theday.com through the election. Our candidates for the 18th District seat, Republican Heather Summers. Heather Summers was a former a town councilor and mayor in the town of Groton. She's a businesswoman and most recently was a candidate for lieutenant governor in the 2014 election. The Democratic candidate for tonight's debate is Timothy Bowles. Mr. Bowles is a former selectman in the town of Preston and a former state representative and was an employee of the state of Connecticut for nearly 30 years. Joining me, my name is Paul Charnier. I'm the editorial page editor at The Day. I'm joined by Tim Cotter, the managing editor, and by Lisa McGinley, a veteran reporter, retired, former deputy managing editor, and now does some work on our opinion pages. I'll ask the audience to refrain from any applause, outbursts during the debate. There'll be no showing of campaign paraphernalia or signs. Please, none of that. And we can save our applause at the end of what should be an hour-long debate. The format tonight is questions will go back and forth between the candidates. They'll have 60 seconds to answer a question. The person who gets that question, the other candidate will have 90 seconds then respond to the same question and offer any rebuttal of what they had heard. And then it goes back to the original candidate who then gets 30 seconds to sum up. And I, at the moderator's discretion, candidates could get an additional 30 seconds if they need a chance to rebut something that was said during the exchange. Towards the end of our debate, we'll provide 1 minute closings and the order was determined by a coin flip. So we're going to get started and the first question again, we did a coin flip to determine. It's going to the Republican candidate Heather Summers and it concerns the budget situation in the state of Connecticut. Despite the fact that Connecticut has among the highest tax rates in the country, though we've seen significant reductions in the staffing of state workers, it seems we continually have one budget crisis to the next. So as if you were elected, what ideas, what changes in structure of government, what revenue-generating proposals might you bring to Hartford to try to address what seems to be a consistent fiscal problem here in Connecticut?
Thank you. Before we get started, I was hoping that we could all take just a few moments for respect for Dudley Wheeler, who was the last four-letter person here in Stonington. He's a longtime Stonington resident. He was actively involved in politics, and he just passed away this past weekend. So I wanted to, out of respect to his family and Stonington RTC, have a few moments for Dudley.
All right. Thank you for that. We'll
now
start
I'll
the clock
right
now with the answer to the question on the budget situation.
Well, everybody knows that we are in a chronic financial crisis in the state of Connecticut. And I believe that that is the result of one-party rule and the policies that we've seen in Hartford. I have many ideas on what we can do to decrease the chronic budget deficit that we have. We're looking at a $2 billion deficit already going into next year. The first thing that I would do is institute GAAP. That's something that the governor ran on in 2010 and did not institute. We are required as municipalities to follow it, businesses need to follow it, and it will give you a clear and transparent landscape of where we truly are financially. We constantly hear about the deficit and the number is always changing. The second thing that I would do is release the $2 billion of tax credits we have for businesses that are sitting being hostaged. If those were released, businesses could invest in their capital expenditures, and that would create tens of thousands of jobs.
Thank you. You have 90 seconds, Mr. Bowles.
I would just like to thank the Day, the League, and the Eastern Chamber of Commerce for the opportunity to be part of this debate, and thank you very much for that. It is very clear that we do have a broken tax system in Hartford. And I have had made very specific proposals regarding what we can do. The first thought and first proposal that I have is let's begin with the legislature itself. I have called for now 2 years, when I was running for re-election as state representative, for a bipartisan legislative commission to take a look at Article 3 of the Constitution. And what I'm proposing, and again, bring Republicans and Democrats, both the Senate and House, to the same table, together with other stakeholders, to take a look at a couple of things. First of all, the idea of running every 2 years is just insane. I'm proposing that we increase the terms for legislators from 2 to 4 years. We are spending all our time and a lot of money campaigning constantly. So that's the first thing I would do. The other thing that I think is appropriate and for us to discuss is the concept of term limits. And I've gotten a lot of pushback on that from a lot of folks, including allies of mine. But I think the idea of having 3-4 year terms, that is a maximum of 12 years, would do a lot to go ahead and really make the legislature itself much more efficient. And then the other thing I'm proposing is that, and I've done this for 2 years, is proposing that we reduce the state legislature, the House of Representatives, from 151 to 108. That's a 30% reduction, so that we have 3 state representatives to every state Senate district. Thank you.
And Heather Summers, you have another 30 seconds
okay.
on that question.
Thank you. I'm not sure how changing the size of the legislature is going to help us reduce our budget deficit whatsoever. Can anyone hear me?
No.
Is this on? Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
How about now?
There you go. I guess we have to keep it right up to our mouth.
Kiss the microphone. Okay. I'm not sure how changing the size of the legislature and increasing term limits is going to help our budget deficit, quite frankly. I think we need to change the business climate and the way we do business here in Connecticut to change the deficit. If we do not institute policies that create job growth and create growth in general, we're never going to get out of our financial crisis. As far as it costing money, that's because we have a citizens' election program here. And I would avow, get rid of the citizens' election program. Term limits are at the ballot box. I've won at the ballot box. I've lost at the ballot box. That's your term limits.
Mr. Bowles, if you could expand on that. Ms. Summers' questions, how does term limits have anything to do with fixing the fiscal problem?
Because,
30 seconds?
Yes. Because campaigning costs a lot of money. It takes a lot of energy. And I just think we need to change that just simply to make the legislative body itself much more efficient. My 2 years up there exposed to me that there's a tremendous amount of dysfunctional processes up there. So I think the idea of really taking a look again at Article 3. I also believe, and I've shared this with before, one of the things that we need to do is take a look at consolidating state agencies. We have far too much administrative overhead in this state.
All right, thank you. And before we move on to another question, you brought up the Citizens Election Program, Ms. Summers. Would you do away with it entirely? It was signed into law by a Republican governor to try to prevent corruption in the state. Could you say why?
Absolutely. We have a CEP program, which is Citizens Election Program here. The reason that I would get rid of it is because we have a governor right now and a state Democratic Party who have done everything to circumvent the rules of the CEP. They are under federal investigation for election fraud, for going around the rules of the CEP. So if our own governor and the Democratic State Party cannot abide by the rules, we should abolish the CEP.
All right, our next question is from Lisa McGinley, and it goes to Tim Bowles.
Thank you. I'm going to stay with the subject of finance for another question. In addition to the suggestions you both have made, We are interested in other ways in which you would create new revenue sources and cut costs. So, Mr. Bowles, would you please respond in general to whether you have other suggestions, and in particular to these two? Number one is changing the collective bargaining arrangement to find savings through lower benefits and greater contributions from state employees. And number two is to reform the property tax system to include some form of payments by nonprofits, including colleges and hospitals.
And that's why, again, I can't stress enough that we need a bipartisan approach to this. The problem up in Hartford, and this is going back to John Rowland, the budget hole that we have dug goes back to three administrations, including two Republican administrations. And part of the issue is that we have not brought the parties together that need to solve this problem. So what I'm calling for is, again, a bipartisan review of our whole budget and tax situation. I think it's imperative that we have some frank and bold discussions about this, and I think we need to take a look at the property tax. It is disingenuous for the state to cut the state budget and place the onerous fiscal constraints on the towns and municipalities. That's not cutting taxes. That's simply shifting the burden from the state to the local municipalities, and I think we have to do something about that.
And Ms. Summers, you have 90 seconds to respond.
Yes, I agree with Mr. Bowles on the property tax.
Turn the mic up. Can
you turn my mic up?
Is there anything we do audiovisually as to why we're having some issues? Perhaps if you could try to.
Okay, I'll talk. Can you hear me now?
I don't know. Yeah, we're having issues. Yeah, we'll see if we can pass this over and we'll share a mic. We'll ask questions with one. Sorry about that.
I just get started and then I have to stop, right? Okay. Can you hear me now? Okay. All right. Well, I would agree with Mr. Bowles on the property tax. You know, when the legislature this year said they didn't cut taxes, but they cut municipal aid, all we're left to do on the local level is to raise the property tax. So that doesn't serve anyone. I put a proposal in when I was the mayor of Groton to try to freeze property taxes for retirees that are 65 years and older. So I definitely think the property tax has to be looked at. As far as your other two questions, as far as what we can do to increase revenue, I think we have to change the business climate. If you look at the United States, all of the growth is coming out of companies that are 0 to 5 years old, entrepreneurial companies. We have no entrepreneurial growth in the state of Connecticut. That means that we're applying resources in the wrong area. If we want to change the course of Connecticut, we have to change the business climate so we become more friendly to businesses, because businesses are the job creators and they pay taxes. It's as simple as that. We can't tax our way to prosperity. We can't regulate our way to prosperity. It simply doesn't work.
Thank you. And you have another 30 seconds if you want to comment further on this exchange.
Well, I think the key thing that we need to do, and the number one priority that I would make, is job creation. We have been living through a very intense recession in this state, and particularly in the southeastern Connecticut. And I think some of the things that have been happening recently is the jobs, electric boat, thanks to Congressman Joe Courtney, they're adding 600 800 new jobs here in southeastern Connecticut. I will also talk a little bit later about what's happening at Preston Riverwalk.
Just to follow up, it was one aspect of that question I didn't hear any comments about from our candidates, so try again. Connecticut has one of the strongest collective bargaining laws in the country that sends discussions to mediation, binding mediation, in the event of an impasse. Some have called for amending that law, feeling it gives it's tilted too much in favor of labor and the cost of labor. So if I could just get our candidates, we'll have 60 seconds each, starting with Mr. Bowles and then Heather Summers, to comment on your feelings about the collective bargaining law here in Connecticut.
You know, the problem here is that, going back again to Governor John Rowland, he was the one that signed off in the negotiations with the state unions on a pension and package deal that's lasting to 2020. I think he was probably aware that maybe it didn't make any difference if he was involved in that or not, but he gave us a sweetheart deal. And the fact is, we have also gone ahead, and the unions have come to the table on three different consecutive times to go ahead and negotiate in good faith to the point that we have diluted and seriously modernized our pension system here. We are now having a tier 3B, I believe, at this point in time. So the pension benefits of old are certainly not the same as they are today. So I believe and respect the collective bargaining process. I think arbitration, binding arbitration, really does well, bodes well for both parties. It's very clear in terms of what the conditions are. So I do believe that we can need to continue negotiations. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Summers, on collective bargaining, your views?
Well, I believe that the governor is the only one who can open that up right now. I think I'm open to everything. We know we have a major crisis. We have a major unfunded liabilities through pensions. I think we can fix this together, but we're going to need the union's help. I believe that Governor Malloy and the Democratic legislature have actually failed the unions. They've lied to them. They've laid them off. The Republicans had a plan last year to fix the budget with no union layoffs. We had a few furlough days. So I think it's time to work together in a bipartisan manner to see what we can do together, not on the union's back, but with the union together to make this work.
All right, thank you. And the next question from Tim Cotter goes to Heather Summers, and you'll have 60 seconds.
Switching gears a little bit. Can you hear me?
Uh-oh. Your turn. Yeah.
Okay. After the Sandy Hook tragedy, the legislature made some changes to the state gun laws addressing background checks, semi-automatic rifles, and ammunition magazines. Do you support further changes to the gun laws? And if so, what would they be? Or do you think that it's fine the way it is?
No one can dismiss the tragedy at Sandy Hook. I am a pistol permit holder myself. I do not think we need any more restrictions. I think we have some of the most restrictive gun laws in the nation. Look at Chicago. They have the strictest ones, and they still have murders every week. I think that people have a right to own a firearm. If you're a young single mother living in Sterling, Connecticut with two children, and somebody breaks into your house, the only equalizer you have between that person and yourself and your children is a firearm in some cases, when it takes 20 minutes for a policeman to show up. So I would not suggest any further restrictions to our current gun laws.
Mr. Bowles, and you have 90 seconds to respond.
Yeah, this is one of the more intense issues that I've ever dealt with as a state representative. I actually voted against the gun bill a couple of years ago, and it's one of the biggest things I've regretted in my life. I voted against it at the time because I listened to my constituents. I sat down with gun collectors, with friends and neighbors, Democrats and Republicans alike, who convinced me at the time it was very onerous. I also, with a behavioral health background, felt that there was not enough in that bill to address the mental health, the critical mental health issues that we have, and clearly that was a presenting problem at Sandy Hook. I have since changed my stand on that. I believe that, for instance, I commend highly the recent bill that was passed to protect victims of domestic violence from gun people, their spouses or significant others that have access to guns, to eliminate that. I also believe that and highly commend the work that Senator Chris Murphy has done on this issue, as well as others. We need a federal approach to the gun problem that we have in this state, in this country. And I would support any effort on that. So I think while the gun law that was passed 2 years ago, and there were a number of legislators in southeastern Connecticut that did vote against it, including Senator Annie Maynard, I think it suffices enough. I think we've made some tweaks in it, including the domestic violence issue.
Thank you. And another 30 seconds to Heather Summers. And just you clarify, would you say you wouldn't add any more restrictions? Would you look to repeal any that were passed as having gone too far?
And you know, at this point, there's no will to repeal, so no, I wouldn't do that. I think the other thing that is not addressed, again, as Mr. Bowles has said, was the mental health aspect. I think we need more access to mental health. I don't think that you can legislate someone who has a mental health issue. I think any further restrictions to our gun laws would only hurt law-abiding gun owners. What I think we should do is get tough on crime. We have an early release program here in the state of Connecticut that has released 22,000 prisoners, 70% of which are violent.
Thank you. Our next question goes to Tim Bowles. I'd like to, and this comes via the Chamber of Commerce, the neighboring states of New York and Massachusetts have tripled job growth since the last recession compared to Connecticut. And what specific actions would you take to help increase private sector job growth in the state, and particularly here in southeastern Connecticut?
Well, one of the things, and I kind of mentioned this before in terms of the work that I did in the Preston Riverwalk, it's an example of what we can do here in terms of energizing the job growth here in southeastern Connecticut. I was able to secure, together with Senator Andy Maynard, $5 million in a federal Urban Act grant to go ahead and finish up essentially the cleanup. Now I'm dead. To finish cleaning up essentially the Norwich State Hospital property, which is now Preston Riverwalk. I have to commend, first of all, First Electman Bob Condon and the Preston Redevelopment Agency and its chair, Sean Nugent, for reaching a memorandum of understanding with the Mohegan tribe that could result in upwards to 700 new jobs on site at the Preston Riverwalk property. I think it's these kinds of cooperative agreements that can really drive, together with what's happening with Congressman Courtney down at Electric Boat, we are finally beginning to see a turnaround here, and let's continue that momentum.
Thank you. Ms. Summers, job growth.
Yes, as far as job growth, I commend your work on the Preston Riverwalk, but it hasn't produced any jobs to date. As far as increasing the private sector jobs, what we need to do is get our fiscal house of Connecticut in order. Every business person you talk to will say, I am not willing to come to Connecticut until I know that their financial crisis is under control. We need to have better access to capital for small businesses. If we want to grow entrepreneurial companies that may spin off from Electric Boat or Pfizer, they need to have access to capital, they need to have decreased and streamlined regulation, and they also need to have someone to help shepherd them through the Connecticut system. It is not helpful in Connecticut when you're a business and you come here and they say, here's the 52 permits you have to fill out in order to become a business. Look at Massachusetts and New York. They've been much more successful because they have been able to garnish private and public money to invest in the future of their states. That's exactly what we need to do here in Connecticut.
All right, thank you. We're trying to correct any audiovisual issues, any audio issues we have. You have 30 seconds, Mr. Bowles.
Yeah, part of the problem, frankly, that I have with this is, you know, the reality is, and I don't know the full circumstances of this, but Heather was involved in getting $1 million loan for her company. I commend her for the work that she did in that company. It looks like a wonderful product. But that company promised to create 143 new jobs here, and it failed to do so. To the point that the company was fined $80,000. So I just think it's somewhat disingenuous.
All right, I'm going to give you another 30 seconds and something.
I'm going to need more than 30 for that. But here we go. Okay.
All right, well, how about 60? And I'll give Mr. Bowles 60 to respond, and then we'll move on to other things. Here you go.
Let me just say that Mr. Bowles does not have his facts correct, and no matter how many times he or the Democrats that write letters to the editor say it, it's just not true. My company never had a loan, ever. Okay? Never had a loan. My company received an investment from a private public organization. At the end of the day, My company has returned $40 million to the state of Connecticut coffers, to the economy, through payroll, capital expenditures, and if you want to go back and look at the actual investment, we have returned 200% between the return of the investment and the taxes paid on the transaction. We were never required to hire 100 people. We were required to hire 100. We fell short. We didn't pay a fine. We paid the penalty. We finished the contract. There's nothing wrong. Nothing was done inappropriately. This is a win for the state of Connecticut. This company is expanding. It's getting larger. It continues to hire people and continues to add tax dollars to the state coffers. This is exactly what we need to do in Connecticut to grow the economy. I was a job creator. I created jobs in the one of the most socioeconomically depressed
have to wrap up, to be fair.
Towns in Connecticut.
Thank you. I'll give you the last 60 seconds, Mr. Bowles, if you'd like to respond.
Yeah, the only thing I have to say really is that I don't know what the distinction is between a fine and a penalty. I guess in my mind it would be equivalent. And again, I commend Heather for the work she did in terms of that company. But the reality is that we need to incubate companies here in southeastern Connecticut that have innovation. I have been a long proponent of clean energy technologies, of green technologies. I think that's the future of much of the job growth here in southeastern Connecticut. I think biotech is also extremely important. I think the work of the sector here in southeastern Connecticut and other parties is also critical in developing a vision, a comprehensive integrated vision of what we can attract here, what makes sense. We have some tremendous assets here in southeastern Connecticut. We live in a beautiful area, and I think we have to capitalize on that in order to sell the whole concept that we have of a quality of life here that you can't find anywhere else.
All right, thank you. Next question will be from Lisa McGinley to Heather Summers, and I will pass across the microphone. We're now sharing.
Thank you. We're changing gears here. The increasing number of deaths from abuse of heroin and opiate drugs is being called an epidemic. It clearly needs even more resources than it is getting, including coordination of law enforcement and healthcare systems. Do you have a plan for improving and expanding services, including prevention, and how would you pay for it?
Thank you for that question. Heroin is a crisis. It's a health crisis. I have been involved for over 2 years. I was one of the first people to found an organization called Shiloh, Shine a Light on Heroin, with Jim Spellman. We were at first called alarmists. But I actually lost a family member at 23 years old to an overdose of heroin during my lieutenant governor campaign. I never had any indication that anything was awry. So I am actively and intuitively and absolutely focused on this issue here. I think we need more access to rehab and medical resources. There's not enough mental health care doctors. There's not enough addiction doctors here in Connecticut. We are losing an entire generation of young people for this chronic disease. I think the legislature, it's the responsibility. This is one of the things that government needs to do with the healthcare crisis and spend money to help save these young people and to spread the awareness and to do what we need to do, reduce the red tape. Try talking to any physician and see if they can get a mental health worker or someone into rehab. It simply cannot be done, and I would be absolutely willing to spend money on this crisis.
Thank you, and Mr. Bowles, the issue is the opioid crisis and what you might do about it as a legislator.
This is the kind of issue which is affecting the very soul of our communities. And this is one area that I would tend to differ somewhat with Mrs. Summers. We cannot look to the state of Connecticut to solve all our problems. We cannot look for state programs and agencies to come up with solutions to this very serious crisis that we have, not only here in the midst of this region, but also throughout this country. As a longtime behavioral health specialist, as a social worker for many years, I was first exposed to the whole concept of drug crisis back in the 80s with the crack cocaine issue, when I saw a spike in domestic violence It is critical that we, and as suggested in the question, that we really develop prevention programs, early intervention programs, and yes, we also need to be able to develop rehab programs as well. But it's going to take a partnership. It's going to take, and if I may use a phrase that's been used before, it's going to take a village. It's going to take all of us together collectively. I happen to belong to a men's group up in my local church in Preston. We have taken on this issue collectively, and we understand, because this particular tragedy has impacted our church, has impacted our community. So I think we again collectively, together with the state, together with the church community, together with other folks that are invested in trying to come up with solutions on this, we need to work together to come up with the way we handle this.
Ms. Summers, you get another 30 seconds if you'd like to respond.
Absolutely. I think the state does have somewhat of an obligation to help. This is a healthcare crisis. I don't believe that the state should fund the entire thing, but I think they have a part to play. They have a part to play in helping get rid of the red tape. They have a part to play in helping municipalities afford Narcan for every single police officer, and I believe that Narcan should be in schools. They have a part to play in helping us develop a collaborative effort between law enforcement, physicians, rehab specialists, and our school systems. So I do think the state has a part to play, but I think this is a very important issue. Heroin knows no boundaries, no socioeconomic boundaries. It does not discriminate, and it comes in all shapes and sizes, and it can be a businessman or a young person. We have to hit this head on.
All right, thank you. Next question comes from Tim Cotter, and it goes to Mr. Bowles.
Returning to the government's role in job creation, the ECD recently deemed the First 5 Plus program a success because it's created 3,700 jobs. Others think it's corporate welfare with the government selecting winners and losers. How involved do you think the government should be in job creation?
I think we have to be careful with this in this particular area. I think the government has a role, but I think it has to be somewhat limited. I think there has been successes. I take a look at the recent numbers coming out of the Jackson Lab up in Farmington, their growth and their success. I think the government primed the pump there in attracting this company from Maine to come down here and relocate. I think that was a significant development and really has really made our biotech industry robust here again. So I think the state has to be a partner, together with regional council of governments, together with private and public sector sectors, to go ahead and really develop this. But the state should have somewhat of a limited role. I think we have not taken the right track in a lot of these areas, and I think we have tended to be a little bit too generous in terms of some of the deals that we've handed to some of the companies.
And you have 90 seconds, Ms. Summers, to comment on the idea of the success or lack of the First 5 and the idea of direct involvement of the state in trying to encourage business growth. And you have 90 seconds.
Sure. As far as the First 5, if you look at who the companies are, one could infer that it really has been play to pay here in the state of Connecticut over the last few years. I don't think paying $35,000 per job is necessarily the way to go. I would like to see investment in small entrepreneurial companies. I think that the state of Connecticut needs to set aside a pool of money that it can help small businesses get started. Our competing states, Massachusetts and New York, have done this. That's why they're successful. All the growth, as I said before, in the United States for companies is coming out of small companies 0 to 5 years old. That does not mean giving a huge hedge fund $27 million. There's a big difference. I also believe that the DECD is very fractured. We have about 5 different organizations doing economic development. What I would like to see is all of those groups consolidated along with tourism, which is a huge economic driver, under one heading, and it'd be titled the Department of International Commerce and Entrepreneurship.
Thank you, and you have 30 seconds for last word on this question, if you'd like it.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And as I said before, in answer to a previous question, I'm a big advocate for some consolidation of state agencies. For a small state, we are extremely fractured in the way we do business. For a small state, we are incredibly bureaucratic, and there are far too many redundancies and too many siloed approaches to this. That is, there are agencies and entities that are working on these issues without any networking, without any common thread to them. And so I feel that that there are answers to this issue. I think it's important for us to go ahead and take a hard look at the bureaucracy that I think impedes business growth here in the state of Connecticut.
Thank you. We're going to continue on the same topic. Next question, I'll go to Heather Summers. And again, this is from the Chamber of Commerce.
We asked my 30-second response to that.
The question began with...
It began with me.
Oh, okay, my mistake.
Sorry.
That's all right. You can correct the moderator anytime I'm wrong. I want to be corrected.
Sorry. I just wanted to add that being the mayor of Groton, I had to work firsthand with DECD, and I can tell you, talking to other mayors that are actually sitting in this audience today, what we experience here as local leaders is if you have a fantastic company you want to bring to your town, the DECD is more than willing to take that company and say, oh, I want you to go to Torrington. So I agree with Mr. Bowles that we need to have a better way to help businesses in Connecticut, because we can't have municipalities fighting amongst themselves to try to bring a business here. The DECD needs to have better communication on the local level so that we can work together to help Connecticut get back on track.
All right. Thank you. It's kind of like following a ping pong match tonight.
And may I just have...
Briefly.
Very briefly. That's one of the reasons why I'm a strong advocate for decentralizing some of the fiscal and policy issues that are made up in Hartford. We need to give the local Council of Governments more autonomy, more jurisdiction over some of these decisions. I was successful in getting the Regional Council of Governments down from 15 to Council of Governments to 9. I wanted 8, but it never happened. But I think the emphasis that I'm placing is really, again, decentralizing funding and policy issues in the state of Connecticut.
All right, thank you. As promised, we're going to stay on the same talk, and this question is to you. Heather Summers.
Sure.
From the Chamber of Commerce, Connecticut faces national and international competition to attract businesses that bring quality jobs and investment. How would you characterize the business climate in Connecticut today, and what would you do to improve it? I think you've touched on some of this, but if you could kind of expand on the issue of quality job creation.
Right. Well, I have to say my company created good quality jobs, and I think we have to look at the economic sectors that are available to us that we do well in, something like something that's spun off of Pfizer or Electric Boat, where you have a highly skilled worker performing a job. I also think we need to look into areas that we're not successful in right now. I sit on the Connecticut Commission for Economic Competitiveness, and I can tell you, interestingly enough, the only growth in population we have had in Connecticut has been international folks coming here for high-paying jobs. So we can do a lot more of what we're doing now. As far as the business climate here in Connecticut, look at the rankings. We are the bottom of the barrel. We need to change if we're going to survive here in Connecticut.
And you have 90 seconds for your response.
Yeah, one of the things that I did when I was chair of the Connecticut Energy Clean Energy Fund was we had a conference, a New England conference, around the issue of taking a look at what was happening in Germany in terms of renewable energy issues. Germany has been the most successful country in the world in terms of really capitalizing and taking advantage of renewable energy, to the point that there are companies in Germany that really are looking for foreign markets to go ahead and export and expand their renewable energy manufacturing and initiatives. with the UConn Clean Energy Center up in Storrs, Mansfield, we have an opportunity to really work, this is just an example, with the Germans and going ahead and attracting to southeastern Connecticut, simply because it's one of the closer business areas geographically to Germany. They are anxious to come ahead and invest some money here. So that's why I've been a big advocate for clean energy programs, green energy technologies. I think that together with, again, the biotech industry and with other things, I think we need to take advantage of these emerging technologies, the innovation that it creates, the brain power that comes with this kind of initiative, and really take a look at fostering a much better climate to attract international investment in eastern and southeastern Connecticut.
And 30 seconds.
Again, this all comes back, we're having the same conversation over and over. This all comes back to, we're not going to attract international companies to come here unless we change the business climate in Connecticut. We have to be more friendly to business, we have to have capital ready, we have to get our tax structure under control, and we have to fix our liabilities. All these things are nice to talk about, but it's not going to happen unless we get our fiscal house in order. That's why I want to go to Hartford to do that.
All right, the next question is going to be from Lisa McGinley, and the first crack at it will be Mr. Bowles, and I'll again pass the microphone.
Thank you, Paul. Should the General Assembly authorize a joint venture third tribal casino on non-tribal land?
Good question. I have never been a big fan of casinos and gambling as an economic driver. I have not been. However, I respect both the Foxwoods and the Mohegan tribe in particular for the investment they have made. But more importantly, I appreciate the fact, and again, I point to the Preston Riverwalk, a memorandum of understanding with the Mohegan tribe, of their willingness to go ahead and diversify. I don't know how a third casino really will work. I think the competition in New England with some of the New York facilities is going to make the whole industry just that much more diluted. And I understand the competition with the proposals up in Massachusetts, but I am leery of going ahead and really spending a lot of energy and time going ahead and acknowledging a third casino. However, I think there are people that are taking a look at it that would certainly debate my premise here, and I would want to take a harder look at the figures and the numbers in terms of the potential growth of such a third casino.
Thank you, and Heather Summers has 90 seconds to respond.
Sure. You know, I've met with both the tribes, and I've had this conversation with them as far as what their intent is, why they want to go forward. And I think that we in southeastern Connecticut are very fortunate to have them here as an employer. They employ thousands of people that go to work every day in their facility. I think we need to support the casinos. I think for us to come out against them would send the wrong message. As you said, you just entered in a memorandum of understanding with the Preston Riverwalk. I think it's imperative for us in southeastern Connecticut to recognize that these are the two casinos that are telling us this is what they need. Again, this goes back to being a business-friendly environment. We need to look at the numbers. We need to make sure things make sense financially, but I want to support the casinos.
Mr. Bowles, you have another 30 seconds if you'd like it.
Yeah, the only concern I have is that by creating a third casino near the Massachusetts border, we run the risk of drawing business away from the two viable casinos that we have here. I absolutely respect both the tribal leaders and both the Foxwoods and Mohegan Sun, the Mashantuckets and the Mohegans. And I think it's important for us to support their efforts. But again, I want to take a harder look at an analysis of that and really continue to encourage them to continue to diversify their business model.
All right. Thank you. The next question to Heather Summers is from Tim Cotter.
One of the victims of the most recent state budget cuts were the regional tourism districts, and tourism is an important industry here. seems unlikely that the cuts would be restored. So can you speak to some alternative ways that tourism could be promoted?
Absolutely. First of all, I would move to restore those cuts. Absolutely, because if we look at Mystic and excuse me, and mostly Mystic, the aquarium, Stonington right here, we are the number one tourist destination in Connecticut. We put more money back into the state coffers than nearly anything else here in the state of Connecticut. Why are we not spending money where we are gaining money? For every dollar we put in for tourism, we get five back. We have new initiatives going on in Groton with a Heritage Park Foundation. I see Mr. Cox right out there. We need to promote our tourism district. It makes no sense. We're cutting off our nose to spite our face. So I would advocate absolutely to add those dollars back in. If not, I think we need to sit down with all of the industries together that are involved in tourism and come up with a collaborative way to try to help fund it. But it makes no sense to me at all that that's where we would cut.
Thank you, Mr. Bowles.
Yeah, again, this is an area where I think we need to empower the Council of Governments to be much more involved in these kind of issues by developing regional budgets where there's some discretionary funding ability to go ahead and restore the funds, particularly here in southeastern Connecticut. I also believe in terms of tourism, I really commend the work of Mayor Marion Galbraith and Senator Andy Maynard in really promoting and establishing the Thames River Heritage Corridor or park. I also believe, and I've been talking about this for a while, that we need to take a hard look, and I've talked to the consultants from Yale about this, we need to take a hard look at eventually extending that designation all the way up the Thames River to both the Mohegan Sun and Preston Riverwalk when it's developed, all the way up to the Norwich Harbor. I think by doing that, we can develop a corridor here in eastern Connecticut that stretches all the way from the mouth of the Thames River all the way up to Norwich and ties in logically and realistically with the last Green Valley National Corridor that actually Sam Gagenson, Congressman, helped establish. We then have an ability to create throughout eastern Connecticut a real active, dynamic tourist corridor that really can attract people from all around the world and take advantage of the many assets that we have, not only down here in Norwich, New London, but all the way up again to Sturbridge.
And you have another 30 seconds.
Sure. Well, I think that's a great idea. The problem with it is it's going to take a lot of time. I think we have a thriving tourism business right here in Mystic and Stonington. And I think that we need to focus on how do we get tourists around, how do we transport them, how do we make it easier for them to get here, and we certainly need to market ourselves much better than we're doing now. We have other states, again, that we're competing for people to come to their state. We've got Massachusetts, we have Rhode Island doing a fantastic job. We have issues with transportation here, so we need to focus on those, and then we can have a long-term plan for what Mr. Bowles is talking about.
Thank you. Our next question goes to Tim Bowles. In the town of Griswold, the state police are taking a serious look at some land along the Patchogue Forest for a new shooting range. They say they're desperately in need of a new shooting range, that the existing facility is inadequate and cannot continue. That's proved very unpopular in Griswold, which is a town in this district. And as the state law is now, my understanding is if the state decides to put it there, it goes there. The town has no say in that. So the question is, should a town have some legal authority to block such a facility if it's not wanted by the people who live there?
Absolutely, no question about that. I was involved in this similar issue early on in my state career when I was working at the Office of Policy and Management, when the state was looking at developing low-level radioactive waste sites throughout Connecticut, and they continued, they did the same thing that they are doing now. They picked a town, whether it was West Simsbury or other towns throughout Connecticut, rose up and fought against it, so the state shifted the siting of that particular proposed facility to other towns. I am strongly supporting the people up in Griswold that are against this. And I have been convinced that we have adequate facilities and other options available to us, including a facility down in East Haven. Take advantage of that. It just does not make any sense to go ahead and site this kind of facility here in Griswold. And again, what the state did is first they were talking about Voluntown, then they moved it over the border to Griswold. I'm very impressed with the grassroots effort that has been made by both Voluntown and Griswold efforts to fight against this proposal. So yes, I believe the town should have a say in this.
Thank you. And Ms. Summers, your position on the proposed shooting range in Griswold?
Well, I have to agree with Mr. Bowles. I've actually attended all of the Keep Griswold Quiet and Keep Voluntown Quiet events that they've had in those two towns. I've spent a lot of time talking to the people that have been involved. And if you go to those towns, you'll see there's more Keep Quiet signs than anything else. Keep Griswold Quiet, Keep Voluntown. My daughter actually sleeps in the T-shirt. I think that towns absolutely should have a say in whether the state is forcing something on them. I would agree. I think there's a facility in East Haven. It's a new National Guard shooting range. I know the state police aren't happy because it doesn't have absolutely everything they want. But, you know, the state of Connecticut and the people living here don't have everything they want either. So I think we need to look at the options that are available. That's one. We could also redo the range that's in Simsbury. The people of Simsbury don't want it there. And what they're trying to do is force it up in the quiet corner of Connecticut where they don't think that the people are going to fight back. We haven't had a voice here in Connecticut, and it's time that people realize that we are strong together and that we don't want it in our backyard.
And if you can use it, you get the last 30 seconds on this one.
No, I think we've touched upon this. Again, I have to express my admiration for the grassroots effort that's been made for citizen advocacy. They're very passionate about this, as Mrs. Summers has indicated. There, I see more signs up there than that really express the feelings of those citizens. And I think they need to, their voice needs to be respected in this manner.
Thank you. I think the next question goes to Heather Summers, if I'm keeping my cheat sheet correct.
Okay.
In this election, in a normal presidential election year, I think we pretty much assume that the Republican candidate would support the Republican presidential candidate and vice versa, the Democratic a candidate would support the Democrats. Not a typical election, I think most people would agree. Both the presidential candidates of both parties are highly controversial and have very high unpopular numbers with the electorate. With that being said, I'd like to ask both our candidates, beginning with Heather Summers, who you will be supporting in the presidential race.
I thought that was going to be the first question, actually, you know? Well, I have to say, I think the most important vote that you can make this election is actually on the state level, because what happens on the state and the local level are where we are most intimately affected. And quite frankly, in our house, I try to say, keep the noise of Washington quiet, because it's like watching the Kardashians, as far as I'm concerned. I have serious issues with both of the presidential candidates. I have grave concerns about them both. But one thing that my parents had always said to me is, it's not what you say, it's what you do. I do not like what Donald Trump says, but I certainly do not like what Hillary Clinton has done. And therefore, I will be supporting my party's nominee at this time.
All right, thank you. And if we could hold the applause to the end, please. Mr. Bowles, what about your candidate? What will you be doing on Election Day, if you don't mind sharing with us?
I think we have two very flawed candidates in Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. I'm disappointed that for a big country like us, this is the two best candidates that we can come up with. That's the question I have. But there is no question in my mind that there is a very serious and distinct difference between the background, the experience, the rhetoric, the tone of these two candidates. I think Donald Trump has invoked a campaign of bigotry and misogyny and hatred that I just really think it divides this country. And I think we need to come together as a community, as a state, as a nation, And I think it's imperative that we have a leader that can do that. And I do believe, and when I go into the polling place November 8th, I will be pulling the lever for Hillary Clinton. Though I have to say...
Okay, you both had your applause now.
That I was a Bernie fan and love Bernie, and just think he has brought just such a healthy perspective in terms of the politics that we are facing. I think he just spoke the truth. I believe in the issues that he raised, including income inequality and a whole host of issues. So I wish, you know, I was running with somebody different on the top of the ticket, but I also feel very proud to be in the position where I'm running with the first woman president. So.
I have to. You have 30 seconds if you want it. Okay. With that, we'll be moving to our closing statements. Both candidates will have 1 minute. We have the timekeepers, so 60 seconds, if you could set that. And we begin with Tim Bowles.
Yeah, as we just following up on, it's somewhat incredulous to me that my opponent is supporting a presidential candidate in a Republican agenda that is so divisive. The partisan divisiveness of this election is appalling. A few years ago, I spoke to a group of school children on Flag Day, and what I shared with them is that after 9/11, for the first year, we came together as a country, whether we were black or white, rich or poor, Republican or Democrat, we rallied around the flag. And I think we need to find a way to get back to that spirit of solidarity in this country. I am running to serve the state senate, to serve the people of this district. Hartford is broken, and I have very specific proposals, including taking a look at the way the legislative does business, including administrative costs. I have a proven record as a selectman and state representative working with Republicans and Democrats to produce results that benefit working families in this community.
Thank you, Mr. Bowles.
We can work together to make this district a better place to work and live. Thank you.
Thank you. And last word, 1 minute, Heather Summers.
Okay, this election is about the survival of our state and its citizens. Are we going to send someone who's a nice guy, but he's already had his chance? Someone who spent their entire career in the state bureaucracy and knows no other way. Someone who stood with Malloy 99% of the chance and the time when he voted, been part of the status quo and the majority that has led us here where we are today. Somebody who will be another vote for the policies that are crippling our economy and devastating our middle class families. Or are we going to try something different and take a new approach and send an outsider who will work for the people of the 18th district, not under those under the Gold Dome in Hartford? I have served for over 14 years on the municipal level. I've been a job creator. I've been an employer. I understand this district intimately. And I also understand that there are no solutions to our financial crisis unless we enact policies that help create jobs and growth in our state. I lead, my opponent follows. And I hope that to earn your vote in the next few months, and hope you will join me this November for our last chance to take Connecticut back.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That concludes our debate. You've been a very respectful audience, and I thank you all for tuning out tonight. Keep following thedayandtheday.com for reports on our election, and make sure you vote November 8th. Good night.